accepted, you were condemned. And I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. I'm forgiven, because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, should die? Because you were forsaken, I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. Amazing love.
Amen. You may be seated. Thank you, team. King died for us. As Team Jesus, we have an important role to play in this world. Jesus has given us this mission, this commission. We're going into all the world and preaching the gospel, making people into disciples of Jesus Christ. I'm excited about the message today. Again, we're going to be in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 10. But this is what I find amazing. I'm kind of, when I'm preparing my sermons, where we're going to go, what I'm going to be teaching, I don't I don't ask Gordon, I don't ask Wendy, I don't ask anybody else what they're teaching. No, God gives me what I'm supposed to be sharing, and this is the route I take. And what I find fascinating is that we've been in 2 Peter. The other studies are in the book of Revelation, but this week it's converged without any of us planning. I go with what God puts on my heart, and today the subject that we'll be talking about in here is the exact same subject the ladies are going to be studying tomorrow and the men are going to be studying on Tuesday. So I think God is trying to say, hey, church, be on the same page. Focus. Now, we have been in verse 10 for a while because verse 10 says, but the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night. That's where it begins, the tribulation period. It ends with the earth being burned up, which we know is at the very end of God's timeline before eternity begins. But we've been discussing about all the events that take place between those two points. And last week we left off with the marriage ceremony. The bride, the church, has made herself ready. We are symbolically with Christ forevermore. That's what the marriage ceremony is, not a real ceremony. We don't really marry Jesus Christ, but we are to be united with him forevermore. And it begins there at the ceremony. And then, and then the amazing days begin. Let's go to this sermon entitled The Return of the King. We're going to go and start where we left off last week in Revelation 19, verse 6. And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude and the sound of many waters, and as the sound of a mighty thundering, saying, Alleluia, for the Lord God omnipotent reigns. Let us be glad and rejoice and give him glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his wife has made herself ready. And to her it was granted to be arrayed in fine linen, clean and bright, for the fine linen is the righteous acts of the saints. Now, verse 9. Then he said to me, write, blessed are those who are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb. So there's this call. And that's, you know, we talked about the Jewish wedding customs last week, especially the Galilean wedding. And there's this feast that takes place after the ceremony. And here, the call to come to this supper. But there's no details given of this supper. Just the ceremony, and then there's this call. And it's what John is seeing. He's so overwhelmed with it. It's just so amazing. Look what he says. And he said to me, these are the true sayings of God. And John says, I fell at his feet to worship him. It was so amazing. He had to worship. And the guy, the angel delivering all this information to him, he fell down. But he said to me, see that you do not do that. I am your fellow servant and of your brethren who have the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. And that's what prophecy can do for you. If we study prophecies, and many people don't, prophecies can get you very focused, very amazed with how God has been working through human history all along. And he has a plan, and it's unfolding right before our eyes. When you study prophecy, and then you go and watch the evening news, you can have your jaw drop open sometimes because, like, wow, they're reporting on what prophets wrote thousands of years ago. It's truly amazing. This call goes out, but there's no details given to us of this supper. Now, some believe, and I'll just throw this out there, some believe that there is a feast in heaven at this point. I don't believe that. I don't see that. Here's what I see. Let's go on. Verse 11. Now I saw heaven open. So after this call, he falls down. The angel says, don't do that. Don't worship me. Now I saw heaven opened. And behold, a white horse. And he who sat on him was called faithful and true. In his righteousness, he judges and makes war. His eyes were like a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. He had a name written that no one knew except himself. He was clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. So again, no details on this feast. Heaven is open, and he sees the Word of God. Who is this that he's seen? How do we know that? He doesn't list him as Jesus. How do we know it's Jesus? In the beginning. So, John here, John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Jesus always existed. He is God. He is the second person of the Trinity. He's always been there from the very beginning. But he was known as the Word before he was known as Jesus. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And then verse 14 of that chapter says, the Word became flesh. That is where he became Jesus that we know as Lord and Savior. Became flesh and dwelt among us. We beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Now let's go back to Revelation 19, verse 11. So John sees Jesus Christ there. But look what it says. Now I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse. Have we seen a white horse already in this book? I know the Bible teacher up there is saying yes. Be quiet, Bible teacher. Have we seen a white horse yet already in this book of Revelation? Who was riding the white horse? The Antichrist. Revelation chapter 6. Now I saw when the Lamb opened up one of the seals, and I heard one of the four living creatures saying with a voice like thunder, come and see, and look, and behold, a white horse. He who sat on it had a bow, and a crown was given to him, and he went out conquering and to conquer. The Antichrist. Satan is always trying to counterfeit the real thing. There's God, and Satan wants to be that God, but he can't be because he's a created being just like us. So he tries to counterfeit. It's amazing if you listen to the tech moguls today, the heads of industry, politicians, the World Economic Forum, the United Nations, so many of these individuals are talking today about the generation of human beings that won't die. Do you guys realize that? Do you know Jared Kushner, Trump's son-in-law, was talking in an interview just a week or so ago, and he says, through technology and through health, eating healthy and exercise, he says, I believe we're the first generation of humans who won't die. And people take him serious. I mean, this was the man who orchestrated the Abraham Accords. This is no dummy. Highly educated, highly respected. Elon Musk, Zuckerberg, all these tech industries, they're talking about not dying as well. And the World Economic Forum, the heads over there are beginning to say, literally, quoting, we are gods. Humanity, we are divine. We're just now learning this about ourselves. We are becoming gods. And gods are eternal. Right? And they're planning this utopia through their own hands, through their plans, through technology. They're planning this utopia where humanity is going to exist forever. Where do you think they got that concept, eternal life in a beautiful paradise? Isn't that biblical? Satan's always trying to counterfeit. Humanity's trying to come up with a way to have eternal life and to live in paradise, heaven, on their own. But there's only one way to eternal life into heaven, and that's through Jesus Christ. The one they are trying to cast off, the one that the World Economic Forum said Jesus Christ is fake news, his resurrection. Humanity is becoming so arrogant that they're beginning to think themselves as gods, and they're talking about the real God as fake, casting him off. That's what's going on here. Satan bringing his Antichrist, the one who's going to lead the world into eternal life and this utopia, their heaven on earth. So he comes riding a white horse. He tries to look like the real thing. But we know, going back to Revelation 19, here's the real one. Here's the real white horse and the real king. Now I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he who sat on was called faithful and true, and in righteousness. Now this does not look like the Lamb of God anymore, does it? It's amazing when you study the book of Revelation, sometimes Jesus appears as a lamb. Other times he appears like this. In righteousness he judges and makes war. He's coming to fight a battle, to fight a war. The ceremony, the wedding ceremony has just happened. Now there's been a call to the great supper, but there was no supper listed in there. And now we see him ready to make war. His eyes were like a flame of fire. That's judgment. He's coming not just to make war, but to judge. On his head were many crowns. Ultimate authority. All authority has been given to him. He had a name written on it that no one knew except himself. He was clothed with a robe dipped in blood. Whew, not his blood. His name is called the Word of God. Is this Jesus here on this white horse who's returning to the earth? Is he coming as loving, gracious Savior? Or angry judge? Lamb of God? Or Lion of Judah? Yeah. Here's another amazing point here. The very next verse, verse 14. And the armies in heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on white horses. Who is that? That's the church. That's us. Been up in heaven for 7 years. We've already talked about what's going on with us during that time. But here we're there and we're ready to return to the earth. How many of you guys can ride a horse? How many of you guys can't ride a horse? You're going to learn real quick. Couple churches back, we had the youth group there, and there was this girl one summer, and we went riding, and she fell off the back of the horse, and they had to take her to the hospital. She was okay. Very next summer, that same girl fell off the horse again. I remember telling her, you're walking this day. No, we'll ride with him. It's amazing. Let's keep going. Verse 15. Now out of his mouth, Jesus is leading, now out of his mouth goes a sharp sword that way he should strike the nations. Now it's kind of a weird sword coming out of his mouth, but what is this talking about? Well, again, Scripture interprets Scripture. You want to know what one passage is really meaning? It's going to be foretold and explained in another passage. So that's why you take all the Word of God together. Hebrews chapter 4. The Word of God is living and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword. piercing into the vision of soul and spirit and the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. There is no creature hidden from its sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of him to whom we must give an account. We've already talked about we're going to give an account to Jesus Christ, who is the Word that became flesh. But the Word here, the Bible, is also referred to as this sharp two-edged sword, piercing into the very heart and soul of everybody in here and everybody on the face of the planet, whether they want it to or not. It's amazing. Spoken word of God. Let's go back to Revelation 19, verse 15. Now out of his mouth goes a sharp sword that with it he should strike the nations, and he himself will rule them with a rod of iron. He's coming back as judge. This earth has been in rebellion. The kings of the earth have been making their own plans, cast God off. We're going to do our own thing. We've all taken part in that rebellion. Hopefully we're not doing that now. We've been born again. We're living now for Christ. But we've all taken part in this rebellion. But the nations, in the end, have really just sealed their fate. Because the Bible tells us these nations have come against Israel. In the end, all the nations, including this one, comes against Israel. And the shepherd of Israel is coming to strike the nations, to judge those who have refused during the tribulation period to repent and be saved. God's grace ends and judgment begins. He's coming back to set everything straight. People have always said, well, if your God was so good, why doesn't he come back and stop all evil? Well, if he did, then usually the person asking that question, because they're usually trying to attack Christianity, the person that's usually, if God came back right now and stopped all evil, they would be stopped as well. They would be judged. And God loves that person, so he's patient. He's waiting for that person to repent. But here is the day. Here is the day that God is going to put all evil and all suffering to an end. Right here. Striking the nation. The rebellion. He himself will rule them with a rod of iron. Now, that's talking about Psalms chapter 2. It's amazing how the Bible all fits together. Psalms 2 is about the kings of the earth pushing God away, and they're going to do their own thing. They're going to create their own utopia. They're going to create their own eternal life. They're going to create their own heaven on earth. But God says up there, and he laughs at their plans. He says, no, my plan. My will, and here's part of the will, to give the world, the nations, to the Son, Jesus Christ. Ask of me, the Father says, and I will give you the nations for your inheritance and the ends of the earth for your possession. You shall break them with a rod of iron. You shall dash them to pieces like a potter's vessel. Psalms 2, written all those couple thousand years ago, fits perfectly with what we're talking about that John wrote in the first century. Let's go back to Revelation 19. That out of his mouth goes that sharp sword, striking the nations, rule them with a rod of iron. He himself treads the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. The imagery here is hard. Do you know what a winepress does? Presses every bit of juice out of grapes. How many of you would like to be put into a wine press and pressed? The imagery here is fierce and hard. He himself treads the wine press of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And he has on his robe and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings, Lord of Lords. Now here, the next few passages are going to be a little rough. Verse 17, then I saw an angel standing in the sun, and he cried with a loud voice, saying to all the birds that fly in the midst of heaven, this is talking about the earth, the atmosphere, come and gather together for the supper of the great God. Now, this is not the marriage supper. The call went out for the marriage supper, but this is a different supper. Telling the birds in verse 18 that you may eat the flesh of kings, flesh of captains, the flesh of mighty men, the flesh of horses and those who sit on them, and the flesh of all the people, free and slave, both small and great. Verse 19. And I saw the beasts, the kings of the earth, and their armies, gathered together to make war against him who sat on the horse and against his army. Then the beast was captured, the Antichrist, and with him the false prophet. They're there with all the nations of the earth to come against Jerusalem and to come against Jesus Christ returning at the end of the tribulation period. Satan has deceived humanity to believe that they're gods and they can take on the living God. They're going to make war, they think they are. But upon Jesus' return, the beast was captured, the Antichrist, with the false prophet, who worked signs in his presence, by which he deceived those who received the mark of the beast and those who worshipped his image. These two were cast alive into the lake of fire burning with brimstone. They didn't even go to hell. Hell and the lake of fire are two different things. First, people who reject Jesus Christ, they go to hell. And then there's a judgment later we'll talk about. And then the lake of fire. Right here, these two bypass hell right into the lake of fire. Verse 21. And the rest who are standing there following the Antichrist, coming against Jesus Christ, who refused to repent and believe. The rest were killed with the sword, which proceeds from the mouth of him who sat on the horse. And all the birds were filled with their flesh. This battle of Armageddon that people have talked about, they've made movies about, it's a battle that is on the plains of Megiddo, there in Israel. The nations have come together with their armies that are left, and they're going to make war. It never actually happens. They're there, but there's no battle. Jesus speaks, and it's done. The wicked die there on the battlefield, and it's not a pretty image. But the birds, the vultures, the hawks, the birds of prey are going to come and fill themselves with the flesh. And then the King of Kings plants his feet upon the Mount of Olives there, meaning the King has returned. Jesus spoke about this moment before his death and before his burial and resurrection in Matthew chapter 24. Immediately after the tribulation of those days, that seven-year period, the sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its light, the stars will fall from heaven, the powers of heavens will be shaken. These are what's happening in the bowl judgments right at the very end of the tribulation period. Immediately after those days, verse 30, then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in heaven. Remember John said, after the call of the marriage supper, then he saw heaven opened. Jesus sitting upon the horse, ready to return. Then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in heaven. And then all the tribes of the earth will mourn. And they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. Whew. Daniel, all the way in the Old Testament, saw this very moment as well. Daniel chapter 7, verse 13. Daniel says, I was watching the night visions. Behold, one like the Son of Man, coming with the clouds in heaven. He came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. Then to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom, that all the peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. Psalms chapter 2, or Psalms 2. His dominion is an everlasting dominion, which shall not pass away, and his kingdom the one which shall not be destroyed. So Daniel, in the Old Testament, God gave him the vision, even way back then. Look, this is my plan. He's going to come in the clouds. He's going to establish his kingdom, his rule upon the earth. Jesus also warned the high priest of this at his trial. Mark 14. And the high priest stood up in the midst and asked Jesus, saying, Do you answer nothing? What is it these men testify against you? So there was all these people coming and lying about Jesus in his trial before the Sanhedrin. And Jesus was just standing there, and he wasn't defending himself. As Isaiah said, he was silent before his accusers. He doesn't need to defend himself against lies. So he remained silent. Verse 61, though, says this. But he kept silent and answered nothing. Again, the high priest asked him, saying to him, now this is where it changes. The high priest is asking him about this false testimony. But here the high priest is directly putting Jesus under oath and asking him a direct question from the authority figure, the high priest. Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed? So Jesus is under oath. And he finally speaks. Jesus said, I am. And you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the power and coming in the clouds of heaven. So Jesus here, about to face the cross, points Caiaphas to the return of the king, the return of Jesus. Caiaphas, hearing this, takes the priestly robes of the high priest and he tears them, breaking the law of Moses. The only one guilty at the trial of Jesus was the high priest. Philippians chapter 2, Paul says this. Therefore, God has also highly exalted him, Jesus, and given him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow. Of those in heaven, and those on the earth, and those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, owner, master of the universe. To the glory of God the Father. The return of the King on that day, and it's a literal day, the end of the tribulation period, the call will go out for the marriage supper. But it's not a supper up in heaven. It's going to be a supper down here upon the earth that's going to last for 1,000 years. I'm going to talk about that next week. For the next couple of weeks, we're going to be talking about that 1,000-year period, what it's all about, why it has to happen. And I'm telling you, we're going to see some amazing things. Whew. But for here, right now, this is where we're here today, is the return of the King. And every tongue will confess Jesus one day. It's best to confess it now. in humbleness and repentance. So you can confess it in this day as in victory and as a follower, part of the army of God. Or you confess it in defeat and in mourning. Because that's what the people will mourn, because their plans have been destroyed. What they want and desire is no more. And now it's judgment. They will still confess Jesus. You know, that name is spoken around the world. It's not spoken in a good way. But you can watch any movie, and if they could get away with it, probably getting away with it on TV now, I don't know, but using the name of Jesus in a foul way. In replace of, if you didn't have Jesus right there, you'd have some cuss word there. Oh, the world speaks that name. But it's not in reverence. It's not for salvation. Because it's the only name given to us that we might be saved. Whoever calls the name of Jesus will be saved. That's not how they use it. We're here to not hate them for that, judge them for it, but we are here to warn them. It's a beautiful name. It's the name of the King, the ruler of this world, who's coming back. But here's what's something amazing. It made me smile when I thought this thought this week. Looking at this day, the return of the King. The day that had been prophesied from the Old Testament to the New. Here's the thought that made me smile. And so I had to write it down. There is a day coming upon the earth when the King of Kings will return. He's going to set up his government. We're going to talk about that in a couple of weeks. But here, the King has returned. And here's the thought. At that point, from there on, no more human queens, kings, presidents, prime ministers, no more human dictators. No more Republicans. No more Democrats. No more politicians. If that doesn't inspire you for Jesus to come back, nothing will. Because remember, politicians, the word poly means many. Ticks are blood-sucking parasites. That's what politicians are. Republican and Democrat. There's some probably decent Republicans, I don't know. But guess what? We're going to talk about that government, how beautiful that government's going to be, what it's going to look like. But from that moment on, government will be righteous. Government will be good. And it'll be a joy to be upon the earth finally. Joy to the world. Sounds familiar, right? Let me show you the lyrics to that Christmas song. Joy to the world, the Lord has come. Let earth receive her King. Did Jesus come as a baby, as King? No. He's meant to be King, but was he King when he came? No. He came to be the Lamb of God, the Savior of the world. But this song talks about Jesus as King. And now, false teachings today, usually amillennialism, says Jesus is reigning as King right now. Not upon the earth. Oh, he's reigning as King inside the church, and so that's on earth. No. Who's reigning on this earth right now? Satan. Don't say Jesus is King of the earth right now. Let the earth receive her King. This is not talking about the first coming of Jesus Christ in Bethlehem. This is talking about what we've been talking about today, the second coming of Christ. Let the earth receive her king. Let every heart prepare him room, because if you don't have room for him, then you're going to be judged. And heaven and nature sing, in 3 weeks, I got a sermon about heaven and nature singing. You want to be here for that one. I'm not going to explain it right now, but it's good. Heaven and nature sing. Heaven and nature sing. Second verse. Joy to the world. The Savior reigns. Is the Savior reigning right now? Even his followers, we have a hard time letting him reign in our lives, don't we? He's not reigning yet. That day's coming. Joy to the world, though, when he does. The Savior reigns. Let men in their songs employ. And he goes on. One more verse. He rules the world with truth and grace and makes the nations. He judges the nations. Psalms 2. And then he rules them. We're going to talk all about this in the coming weeks. What this millennial reign is like. But let's just start right here. The return of the king. How great and glorious this day will be. Finally, truth and righteousness will reign upon the earth. Amen? Amen. Team, come on up. We're going to sing this song as we go out today. It's usually sung at Christmas, and it's okay to sing it at Christmas, but in actuality, it's talking about the day Jesus returns. So let's stand up. Let's sing Joy to the World.
Sure.
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, oh, we wait for that day. We wait for that day. The day that heaven will open. We're going to see you upon that horse. And you're going to return to the earth, and we're going to be following you. And you're going to establish your reign, your government that's upon your shoulders. Righteousness will rule the day. Lord, it's almost hard to believe when we look at the world today that one day it could be filled with your righteousness. But Lord, that's what you've promised. And what you say is going to happen is going to happen. And Lord, we hold on to that promise. And we can't wait. But until that day happens, Lord, until you take us home, let us be about your business. Right now, to the world, you are the Lamb. You are the Savior. We can tell them about the King who is going to return in judgment, and they need to repent. But right now, grace is open to them. They can be saved. They can be forgiven. They can be born again. That's what you said. If one was going to see this kingdom that's coming, they have to be born again. So, Lord, I ask you to help us to be about your business. And when the world gets heavy and it gets dark and we lose hope because we've lost focus, I ask you to help us refocus on you and on this day when the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords will return and plant your feet there in Jerusalem. Let us hold on to that, Lord. And let us live for that day. In your name, in the name of Jesus Christ, amen. 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 All right, team. You know, I'll probably stop this when we get done with Peter. I'm probably going to stop this. I don't know. It just depends. This whole team concept. I mean, we continue, but it was just for 1 and 2 Peter. We're going to come to a close in 2 Peter. But we can't forget this understanding that we are a team and we are to be living with purpose. With purpose. Let's go out there this week. Let's do our best to show Jesus Christ and how we treat people, how we work, how we do school, how we drive in traffic. Try to show Jesus Christ. And then if we get the honor of speaking Jesus to somebody, take it. Let's show Jesus Christ. Let's warn people. All right, let's go. On the count of three, let's break out of here with that joy of the Lord. Count of three. One, two, three. Break. Let's go.